McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Work Better Together, How to Cultivate Strong Relationships to Maximize Well-Being and Boost Bottom Lines, by Jen Fisher and Nguyen Phillips, narrated by Eva Wilhelm. Publisher's note, in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. Bringing Our Whole Selves to Work. If social psychologists invented a global experiment to determine human capacity for surviving paradox, they'd come up with something resembling the modern workplace. We are more connected than ever, and yet loneliness is epidemic. We are rich in information, but deciding what to do with that information is more difficult than ever. We can achieve more from our desktops than ever, and yet we are physically and mentally exhausted. Our best work is fueled by positive emotions like empathy, creativity, and shared purpose, and yet we measure our worth exclusively in quantitative terms. Our teams are ever more interdependent, and yet we cling to bureaucratic silos and hierarchies that discourage cooperation. And as we write this book in 2020, in a cruel amplification of our predicament, the interdependence of employees has been battered by the fight against the COVID-19 pandemic. The psychological strain of physically separating from one another is not the least of the pandemic's ill effects. Long before workplaces went remote or closed, we, Jen and An, were already studying the ways in which work technology affects our well-being. Communicating via teleconferencing, improvising work schedules around childcare, supporting employees who were burning out, all this was on our radar before 2020. The irony of starting a book about these topics in 2020 is that all the changes that concerned us accelerated, and all the problems we studied were suddenly increased for millions. The remedies for workplace burnout became even more urgent because of the pandemic. This book is thus about how to begin the process of change right away. Psychologists have noted that the inability to control a situation, especially when we've had control or think we should have control, can create a major source of anxiety. This, in turn, can greatly add to our stress levels. The good news is that there are things we can do to help take care of our mental health, especially when it comes to dealing with stress and negative emotions. In fact, one of the most important first steps is to focus on those things you can control. We wrote this to provide information you can put into action to cope with stress and build resilience. We start with you, the individual, and work out in a series of radiating circles to describe steps that will help your team, your organization, and the extended world, customers, community, and society. As enthusiastic users of technology, we love the innumerable ways it improves our work and our lives. As a well-being expert, Jen, and researcher on digital transformation, An, we also know how easily human interaction with technology becomes habitual and even addictive to the point that its benefits are outweighed by the negative consequences. One of the topics of this book is about making our interaction with technology benefit our individual and collective well-being as much as our productivity. In that sense, it's also about understanding the meaning of work and making conscious trade-offs between the pain and the gain in our relationship to technology. And more importantly, our relationships to each other. We will also focus on the blurring line between personal technology, such as social media, and work technology. They used to be separate in design, purpose, and interaction, but in the past decade or so, people's interactions with their smartphones feel more and more like interaction with work technology. Making meaning. The American novelist and philosopher Benjamin Hale observed, "We, and I mean humans, are meaning makers. We seek to find meaning in our daily decisions, actions, and relationships, and especially our work. Thanks to digital work technology, it's easy to connect with people thousands of miles away. Social media also provides us with hundreds, sometimes thousands, of connections outside of work. But how meaningful are those relationships? It's a vital question, because a sense of meaning provides us with the sense that our lives matter. Degrees of meaning differentiate our relationships at work and home. It's easy for social media to create a false sense of connection, and that's in part why we are lonelier today than ever before. More than 40% of Americans say they're lonely. And a growing body of research shows this is, quite literally, bad for our health, raising our risk of stroke, heart attack, even dementia. At the same time, most of us spend more than half of our waking hours, 5 days a week, at work. The rest is typically spent running errands, preparing meals, we hope exercising, and tending to family needs. Thus, the workplace seems like a natural place to begin to solve, or at least lessen, the isolation and feelings of disconnectedness. But here's the scary reality. Only a fifth of employees have a best friend at work. And the current climate in most of our workplaces is only taking away from that even more. Surveys suggest that employee satisfaction and engagement are declining over time. Only about a third of U.S. workers are psychologically committed to their jobs. Trust in organizations and their leadership is also low. Burnout is on the rise. In a Deloitte survey of the external marketplace, 3 out of 4 respondents said they have experienced burnout in their current job, with more than half saying they felt burned out more than once. In that survey, we asked respondents how they deal with their burnout, and 51% say they talk to friends or family. It's not much of a leap, then, to say that human connections can be healing. Even when we are inclined to change, the way in which we work today can compound the problem. There's the increase in remote work, like telecommuting and gig jobs, both of which typically don't come with regular, repeated person-to-person interaction. Even when those jobs do, the connections are rarely meaningful. How close can you get to someone during a 10-minute car ride? People who work in an office are more connected, or at least have the potential to be, but sometimes it feels easier to just send an email than it does to walk down the hall for an in-person chat. Here's another important nugget to know about workplace relationships. While the idle water cooler catch-up is technically connecting, the type of relationship, as well as with whom, matters too. It's not just about everyone being on friendly terms or having a forced drink together every now and then at a work mixer. The relationships have to be deeper than that, and ideally with some of the people you work with most often, i.e., your team. You need trust and the feeling that your coworkers genuinely value and care for you. This book was born of a similar necessity. As co-authors, we have both experienced the power of meaningful relationships in the workplace, and we've also seen what happens when we overlook making those connections. Then, as we dug into the research on meaningful workplace relationships, we noticed the number of studies, surveys, and reports was growing. Each of us has also come, though in different ways, to truly value the workplace relationships we each have. For if it weren't for our work family, we'd both likely be in different career places. Jen's story. I remember the moment I realized that meaningful relationships are key to not only being a great colleague, but also being a great manager. It was the day that a member of my team, a team that I had been managing for a few years, came to me and said, "I don't want to work for you anymore." It wasn't the job she was leaving. It wasn't the organization she was leaving. It certainly wasn't the team she was leaving. It was her manager that she wanted to leave. And I was that manager. It's a jarring moment for managers to learn that they might lose one of their best employees. But to learn that it's because of your management is another thing altogether. It makes you immediately reflect on who you are as a colleague and manager. It also gives rise to the question, why didn't I see this coming? And the answer was simple. I wrongfully assumed that I could expect things from her without asking, checking in, and making time for personal interactions. I just assumed she'd always be there. And I almost paid a very big price for it. Although I wasn't able to keep her on the team, it did give me the opportunity to reframe my management approach so that this incident would never happen again. And today we remain friends. I will always remember that pivotal moment in my own leadership journey. It's a moment that I share often with others as a cautionary tale, and it's what led me here to co-author this book. An's story. I remember when my daughter was about 6 or 7, and we went to a family dinner where she would get to spend time with cousins she doesn't often see. She was so excited about sitting at a separate table with her cousins. But when I glanced over to check on her, all the kids were on digital devices and she sat there next to them bored and sad. On the ride home, I asked her how dinner was. She said that she didn't have fun because most of the kids were playing separate games and just keeping to themselves. Fortunately, that was not the typical interaction, or lack of it, my daughter has with her cousins. But that day stuck with me. It was like a precursor to adult behavior we've all seen in restaurants. A group of adults at dinner and all of them on their devices. It reminded me of the patterns, habits, and traps we're all falling into, and how we are passing those habits to the next generation. I used to be one of those managers who was nearly solely focused on getting stuff done, being efficient, and making progress. I was constantly driving activities, and I had zero time for what I considered idle chit-chat, like talking about what everyone did over the weekend. In time, however, I learned that meaningful relationships with team members helped us all to better achieve our goals. The work is easier to complete, and as a team, we are more effective and efficient and have fewer miscommunications. What's more, there is more creativity and engagement among us, a better sense of common and shared purpose, and a strong sense of trust and support for each other. We feel more human, and we also have more fun. Reflecting on the 20-plus years of working in various roles, from technology implementation to project management to research, through this lens, I realized that the biggest challenges I've seen teams face were rooted in people and relationships, and rarely the technology, the deadlines, or the actual work. As I became a researcher and started exploring how organizations navigate their way through a digital age, I found that people are often at the center of challenges and successes. In my research on how companies are reinventing themselves in a digital age, most leaders we interviewed said that the technology is the easy part. The harder part is undertaking organizational and cultural change, developing and retaining talent, and being more innovative. And at the heart of these endeavors are ideas and actions performed by people, not machines. Well-being as a foundation for the workplace. There is another increasingly urgent reason we need more human connection in the workplace. As AI, or artificial intelligence, begins to take over some of our routine, repetitive work, the nature of the work that will remain will be highly cognitive, creative, and intellectual. These are the so-called soft skills, the right brain, subjective, most human skills, and they are the skills of the future. Other critical soft skills in greater demand include empathy and emotional intelligence, critical thinking, embracement of change, interpersonal communication skills, and authenticity. Ultimately, acquiring and implementing these skills will make us better at collaborating and will strengthen our human connections in the workplace. They will also enable people to work better with automation and AI in what Deloitte calls the age of with, where the most human qualities partner with the most powerful digital capabilities for optimized outcomes. But here's the challenge. Showing your human self can be scary. We're inclined to stick to the superficial chit-chat because it feels safe. Think about a time that you had to share something deeply personal with your boss or with a coworker on your team. I'm pregnant. I'm getting divorced. I have cancer. Or my significant other lost his job. How did you feel in the moments that led up to that disclosure? Showing our vulnerabilities or disclosing what feels like too much makes us worry that we will be seen as weak, less competent, or exposed. We have to move past that worry because showing our vulnerabilities is one of the keys to having authentic human relationships and building trust. We also have to become more open-minded to others' experience and points of view. Whether that's one-on-one or as a team, our ability to welcome our vulnerabilities and our strengths into the workplace will increase our happiness and our effectiveness with one another. With some intention, a commitment to thinking differently, and an understanding of the benefits, being more human at work is doable. And that is the goal of this book. In the following chapters, we lay out the importance and value of meaningful workplace relationships. Then, based on 40-plus combined years of experience, we supply you with the tools to invest in cultivating true, authentic relationships in your workplace, regardless of who you are or how many people you lead. We don't claim to have all the answers, nor do we imply that we are experts in relationships. We are human and have certainly made many mistakes in the past. But we are passionate about the power of meaningful relationships at work, and we've pulled together our learnings from our research and experiences to share with you. In the way that companies have really begun to embrace corporate social responsibility and are implementing programs to help improve the physical health of their employees, both of which also financially benefit their bottom line, it's time that organizations and their leaders prioritize their employees' psychological well-being. Stepping into a new world. A 2020 Deloitte report noted, "By 2017, as the tensions between humans and technology continued to accelerate, it became clear that an even more radical transformation would be required to enable humans and technology to work productively together. We suggested that organizations needed to rewrite the rules to navigate the exponential change that arrived with the full onset of the digital age. Those new rules would require more than merely inserting technologies into existing structures and processes. Instead, organizations needed to think about how to redesign jobs and redesign work in ways that represented a fusion of, rather than a trade-off between, humans and technology. With the recognition that technology, human, and business issues are not separate but intertwined, came the realization that these issues would have to be approached in new ways. At Deloitte, we and our colleagues believe that the task of redesigning jobs and work emphatically includes designing well-being in the flow of work. This was evident long before the pandemic emergency of 2020, because the forces working against well-being have been growing for decades. We cannot predict the course of the global pandemic. Perhaps by the time you hear these words, the disease and economic havoc it caused will be behind us. But the pandemic did not cause the workplace problems we'll examine here. It focused our message and reinforced the urgency of the need to change. History is not linear. Its cycles and breakthroughs, its unintended consequences and unrealized currents all humiliate most predictions. As we review the economic and business predictions based on pre-2020 data, we're reminded that black swan events make interpretation of trends very difficult. The COVID-19 pandemic raises questions that could resolve in completely different directions. For example, as economies recover and people go back to work, will the labor market snap back to pre-2020 low unemployment rates, or will businesses, reserving cash for another rainy day or a return of epidemic conditions, be reluctant to hire? Will economies grow their way out of recession quickly and at a steady pace, or will continued or renewed shutdowns create a regionally and industry-specific asymmetric recovery? For example, will hospitality, sports, and entertainment businesses lag manufacturing, construction, and professional services? Will 2020 permanently change the workplace? Will remote work be the new normal? How will mass virtual work impact human interaction and organizational culture? What will this do to well-being as the boundary between work and home blurs? What will it do to our relationships at work? We hope that, however the economic and business story of the next 2 to 5 years plays out, the better impulses that so many of us found in the pandemic remain. We hope the workplace can foster a renewed spirit of community and cooperation and mutual respect. This will only happen if we find the courage to transcend the attitudes and habits that brought us here. We, and by that we mean the two of us and you, all of you, can expand the idea of well-being to embrace the physical, mental, financial, and spiritual health of anyone in that community we call the workplace. Crises and longer disruptions demand innovation for the simple reason that what worked yesterday isn't working today. This happens during wars, massive industrial innovation, pandemics, medical breakthroughs, and economic and political crises, such as the Great Depression, as well as cultural turning points, the civil rights and women's movements. Innovation will continue in technology, medicine and manufacturing, and also in business models and ways of doing business, public-private partnerships, government use of universities as laboratories of invention, sustainability and clean energy investment and technologies, and the movements to make workplaces more diverse, inclusive, and psychologically safe. Becoming more human at work and nurturing the best in our relationships is the next great innovation. Part 1. Our Critical Connections. People live within a dynamic web of connections. At work, at home, in the community, and wherever else we go, our relationships with other people shape how our lives are spent, interacting with our unique qualities like skills, temperament, values, and knowledge. It's easy to take these connections for granted, and yet, unless we are aware of the qualities of those connections and make deliberate choices about them, we can be swept along in a tide of unconscious habits that don't reflect our truest selves. When that happens, our most valued work and most important relationships never reach their full potential. Part 1 consists of 3 chapters that explore these ideas. Chapter 1 reviews the ways in which our habituation to technology at work and home is subtly undermining the purpose of having technology in the first place, that is, to make our lives better, more productive, and more attuned to our work and personal values. The connection between our original intent and our current relationship to technology needs resetting, or our own well-being will continue to suffer. In Chapter 2, we'll show how connection to other people is essential to mental and physical health. Relationships based on trust create meaning. Strong relationships prevent burnout and bolster engagement at work, and we need to build better connections. Chapter 3 calls on us to rethink our connections, to become more aware of their different qualities, and to move from a reactive to a mindful relationship with both people and technology. Chapter 1. The Great Disconnect. We used to work with our hands for many centuries. Then we worked with our heads, and now we're going to have to work with our hearts, because there's one thing machines cannot, do not, and never will have, and that's a heart. I think we're going from hands to heads to hearts. Tom Friedman. Ellen is a senior executive at a global firm. Note, Ellen is a fictional compilation of many executives we have observed. Full names indicate real people who agreed to share their stories and insights with us. End of note. She manages more than 200 technical and professional people who work in cross-disciplinary teams at several locations. She has high expectations of herself and her teams. Ellen prides herself on practicing the best management techniques, and she delivers. Year over year, her teams are rated among the most accomplished in the company. She takes a hands-off approach, acting as a coach, mentor, and strategic thinker, and avoiding micromanagement. And she uses the latest business technologies to do her work. Throughout the day, she's on email, teleconference apps, and her smartphone. At any moment, she might switch from answering urgent requests to setting a check-in on her calendar to writing a note of congratulations to her niece, who earned academic honors this semester. There are days when Ellen's mind seems like an extension of all the technologies she uses to stay in touch. And yet, Ellen has long had a nagging feeling that she is somehow becoming less connected to her team, her work, and even her friends. The endless activity online assumes a life of its own. She can't help checking messages even when she's on the phone. While she studies a report or proposal, some part of Ellen's mind is still turning over her to-do list for the day. More and more, Ellen notices that 10 or 20 minutes have passed focusing on some low-priority task, as if she just needed a break from the intensity of the minute-to-minute information processing and communication that make up her 50-hour work week. Once she notices her distractedness, Ellen sees it in everyone around her, from her team to her fellow executives. What was once a deliberate consideration of ideas is now a fast search for the data point that would enable a quick decision. What was once social interaction, in calls or in person, has become a kind of information tennis match with everyone volleying ideas, data, questions, requests, comments, greetings, opinions, and anything else that comes to mind. Non-stop throughout the day. The situation isn't much different after work hours. In fact, there are fewer hours that are truly walled off from work. Ellen habitually checks emails on her phone one last time before bedtime. Lately, she tries to observe a no electronics after 8 p.m. rule, only to break it and add disappointment in herself to her never-ending list of stressors. Nobody told Ellen she should never stop working. In fact, her company recommends that people not work 24/7. But the stream of emails, messages, and information never stops and always threatens to overwhelm her and everyone else. Ellen and her colleagues are caught in a paradox, more connected than ever, but actually connecting less. And several colleagues have confided to Ellen that, while they are performing more activities and even hitting all their performance goals, they share her sense that they are less insightful, creative, or accomplished these days. We talk about network congestion when there's so much demand for information that our computer networks slow down, says Ellen. That's how I feel some days. If Ellen's situation sounds familiar to yours, it's because this is becoming a common picture. We have steadily progressed toward a tech-heavy, information-overloaded, 24/7 workplace culture. From email communication to video conferencing, it feels, literally, like our networks are congested. Even worse, the incoming workforce lacks essential soft skills, which is very much a result of our tech-focused lives. In short, since the industrial age, we have adopted more and more and more technology, but many of us haven't adapted all that well to it. Now we're facing the downstream impact. We are overloaded with data and activity, but we have lost meaningful human connection, particularly in the workplace. The mania for efficiency. In 1911, engineer Frederick Winslow Taylor published The Principles of Scientific Management. It was the first modern study of work, aggregating a lifetime's ideas about how any work can be measured and made more efficient. Taylor advocated scientific analysis to determine how much work a first-class worker could do in a day and to identify the best employee for every job. He believed that planning departments staffed by clerks could map out everyone's work in advance, moving employees, very much as chessmen are moved on a chessboard. Even as he stressed the need to overcome people's natural laziness, he also wrote, "If the workman fails to do his task, some competent teacher should be sent to show him exactly how his work can best be done, to guide, help, and to encourage him, and at the same time to study his possibilities as a workman." We might recoil in horror at such mechanistic views of human employees, but Taylor's outlook reflected his time, when increasing efficiency in every business, think railroads, steel mills, sewing machines, telephones, electric lighting, was generating unimagined wealth and new possibilities for material security, at least for those fortunate enough to share in the gains. Though Taylor's methods are obsolete, his urgent search for efficiency in every working endeavor still permeates our work cultures. We still want to do more, produce more, accomplish more. Our management methods are more humane, but our most successful businesses and technologies still emphasize efficiency, though we might call it frictionless commerce, online shopping, or instant satisfaction, video streaming, or even curated experience, news aggregators. Now we work on digital platforms that provide tremendous efficiencies by acquiring and distributing information at the speed of light. Software teams around the globe code so that an application is continuously built, tested, refined, and deployed. Warehouse systems receive orders, command robots to pick and package items, and maintain inventory while humans supervise the processing of information. Oil rigs pass information on their output to hubs that balance demand and delivery. office teams continuously update each other on every kind of knowledge work. And every activity, by human or robot or information processor, is continuously monitored and observed against the urge to become more efficient. This digital Taylorism is embedded in daily work even in the most advanced and prestigious jobs. While the 40-hour work week was enacted into law in 1940, it reflected the physical stresses of laboring in factories and fields and applied to hourly workers requiring overtime pay for more than 40 hours of work. But salaried workers are exempt from overtime rules and generally expected, by both company policy and social pressure, to work as long as it takes to achieve goals. This is the lifestyle we call workism. Eat lunch at your desk, work late, bring work home, check email before bed and on the weekend. It's a formula for actually working a 50, 60, or even 80-hour work week. At the top of the economic pyramid in Silicon Valley and Wall Street and the glass towers of America's business districts, working long hours is a badge of honor. Many people can work a long week for a limited time, but studies show that chronic overwork doesn't result in greater output because after a certain amount of work time, it varies by person, productivity declines. And in the long run, stress-related health problems such as depression, diabetes, heart disease, and sleep disorders have a huge impact on productivity. The average knowledge worker receives more than 100 emails a day. We learn new applications and new features, trying to manage the workload, inadvertently adding even more activity. Knowledge workers are interrupted 50 to 60 times a day. Many communication apps adopt a timeline or newsfeed interface, a continuous stream of call and response. If notifications are turned on, a flag jumps into view or a smartwatch buzzes, setting off a Pavlovian urge to check out the new information. Dan Lyons, author of Lab Rats: How Silicon Valley Made Work Miserable for the Rest of Us, cites a familiar scenario. You have the tyranny of this app on your computer all day long, and it's constantly popping up. You're trying to work, and you feel compelled to answer. You get nothing done because you're constantly trying to stay on top of this conversation or multiple conversations. What about multitasking? In the sense of concentrating on several tasks at once, there is no such thing. Research psychologists use the term task switching for behaviors like reading an email while talking on the phone and scanning a timeline. The continuous shifting of attention hurts productivity by cramming a number of partially done tasks into one short period of time. Rapid task switching can reduce productivity by as much as 40%. Multitasking at work is about as efficient as texting while driving, and there's a reason that's illegal in 48 states. It takes about 23 minutes to get back on task after an interruption, and somewhere deep in our workism-trained psyche, we sense it. People react to interruption by working harder and longer, resulting in elevated levels of stress, frustration, workload, effort, and pressure. The theme of doing more in less time is a quiet drumbeat underneath so many company cultures that we hardly notice it. And the promise of efficiency and productivity is part of the pleasure we feel when we discover a new technology that helps us do more, or at least appear to do more. Answering an email, responding to a message, learning a new bit of information, all can feel like really accomplishing work. Our brains get that little shot of dopamine, similar to the habit-forming pleasures of social media. And we become habituated to the information torrent so that it becomes our cognitive new normal, proceeding faster and faster. Only that little nagging sense that we used to get more done in less time interrupts the pleasurable flow of call and response. Innovation, empathy, humanity, and technology. While efficiency helps productivity, getting caught in a never-ending search to do more and more is actually damaging our ability to focus on the human capabilities that are most valuable in the knowledge economy. As efficiency was a key tool of the 20th century industrial economy, The 21st century knowledge economy requires innovation, empathy, creativity, collaboration, leadership, and emotional intelligence. Business journals burst with urgent suggestions for bringing these subjective talents to our workday. In a globalized and heavily digitized world economy, the growth of a business relies on innovation, producing a product or service that is qualitatively better than what's out there. Innovation happens when diverse populations, all kinds of minds, work together to imagine new solutions to problems or create new business opportunities. Disruptive technologies like cloud computing and artificial intelligence power innovation in ways barely imagined just a few years ago. Economies are shifting from an age of production to an age of imagination, notes a Deloitte report. In the past, business success relied mainly on deploying precisely calibrated skills to efficiently construct products or deliver services at scale. Today, success increasingly depends on innovation, entrepreneurship, and other forms of creativity that rely not just on skills, but also on less quantifiable capabilities such as critical thinking, emotional intelligence, and collaboration. Over the centuries, work has evolved from primarily agricultural to industrial to knowledge work. During the agricultural and industrial ages, people worked primarily with their hands, doing physical labor. In the second half of the 20th century, that shifted more to knowledge work, stereotyped by the 9-to-5 desk job. But today the nature of work is shifting again, requiring an elevated level of mental performance to solve problems and come up with new ideas, and with that a new need for softer skills of communication, creativity, empathy, and emotional intelligence. As Tom Friedman describes it, we are shifting from working primarily with our hands to our heads and now to our hearts. A balance of technical skills and social skills distinguishes many jobs at the high end of compensation, prestige, and organizational power. For example, as algorithms take over much of the quantitative work of financial analysis, financial managers need strong social skills to talk with customers, investigate their needs, and design custom investment plans. Management analysts still need to conceptualize abstract ideas and create spreadsheets, but they also need to understand company culture, habits, and social dynamics. Systems researchers and computer engineers, obviously gifted in math, need strong communication skills in order to connect with the business problems they're trying to solve, as well as manage teams in today's agile development environment. Even the most quantitative, fact-based jobs are demanding more and more soft skills. A review of job postings for data science and analysis jobs showed greater demand for creativity, teamwork, problem-solving, and even writing than the average of all jobs. More and more jobs are requiring a combination of left-brain and right-brain skills, sometimes referred to as hybrid skills. The job market is dynamic. Different skills become more valued as the business environment changes. As robots and algorithms take over routine tasks and entire jobs, people have to shift to different types of work requiring creativity, collaboration, emotional intelligence, and connection. We are just in the middle stages of a transformation. AI lacks emotional capabilities. For the moment, a new set of AI technologies called affective computing is attempting to help computers better understand humans and to correlate events with human emotions or emotional factors. How will we respond if our technology becomes emotionally intelligent? Will we become even more deeply embedded in the demands of our work tools, or be liberated by them? And how steep will this learning curve become as technology more closely resembles real people? For some, the prospect of learning a new set of skills is exciting, but for many, the new world of ever-changing job requirements is threatening. The biggest obstacle to success in a transforming work environment might be ourselves. Pressure to perform mounts at the same time that requirements and goals change. A Deloitte study of these changes noted that, with any disruptive transition, We tend to experience fear and stress, generating an impulse to hold on to what has driven success in the past. We must resist that temptation and use the shifts in the nature of work and employment as an opportunity to achieve more of our potential. The health consequences. Because we've adopted technology faster than we've adapted to it, we're paying the price with our physical, mental, and emotional health. Caught up in the shiny promise of new technologies and also facing an ever-changing demand for skills, we struggle to keep up. The 2020 Edelman Trust Barometer found that more than 60% of people surveyed believe that the pace of change in technology is too fast. It's more than the speed of change. It's that the change is still accelerating. Over the past 2 to 3 decades, the pace of technological progress and the speed of its diffusion across countries have been startling, noted an OECD report in 2019. For instance, while it took over 7 decades for phone penetration to go from 10% to 90% in U.S. households, it took only about 15 years for mobile phones and just over 8 years for smartphones. Such technological leaps have had major impacts on the way people work and live. Is the 24/7 workplace culture making us incredibly productive? No. In fact, the inexorable ramping up of attention time is making people less productive. And it certainly is making them more anxious, less happy, less healthy, and less engaged at work. The consequences.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.